Friends, we discussed D.S. Lawrence, and our focus is to be on Sons and Lovers, the text for which he is famous. And he had a lot of experiences before he started writing this novel with respect to the society in which he lived and the world, you know, of which he tried to make sense. So we now focus upon his major novel, Sons and Lovers. And Dr. Richa Bajaj, please give us an analysis of the novel, Sons and Lovers.
I don't know if I can give an analysis of the novel in this span of time, but I would like to begin with talking about some of the issues and themes that you find in Lawrence in general, and then some specific themes that one can find in Sons and Lovers. I think we should be able to cover that bit. So, viewers, the some of the issues that I would like you to look at, and you can look at the screen for this, you will find that we were discussing this in the previous lecture. The idea of a pre-modern consciousness or a primitive consciousness, which is basically returning to intuition and spontaneity, where Lawrence seems to find that the secret source of joy in life is to be found in this kind of simpler ways of life, or this kind of primitivism. Now, this basically means that intuition and your own sense of right and wrong, which you will find that Paul Morel in the novel Sons and Lovers is able to reach finally. He goes through several processes wherein he thinks perhaps this is right or that is right, and finally he comes to believe that his own sense of inner life and his inner sense of justice is what should be the center of his life and should be the belief system that he would like to hold on to. So intuition and a sense of spontaneity is something which is very important to Lawrence, and this is that consciousness is the true consciousness of the human being, according to Lawrence. It is not and in a way it is a rejection of societal norms. It's a rejection of societal structures and hierarchies that tend to define the human being in very normative ways, and also at the same time in very defined or cliched ways. It's almost like each human being is a clone of another. So Lawrence wanted that individuality, and related to primitivism is this idea of individuality. He wanted to retain that individuality that the self is able to carve on one's own without it being destroyed or without it being in any way harmed by society. And the closer one stayed to nature, the better one was able to realize that self in Lawrence. So in that sense, this primitivism gets joined with the idea of individualism and at the same time with the idea of nature. So nature in that sense is not entirely a romantic entity. It is that living, throbbing being that is as important and valuable as the human being oneself. And for Lawrence then, in order to realize the human self in its complete form, in its full form, one only had to come in touch with the joys of natural life. So nature in that sense assumes a primal kind of an importance in Lawrence. So you would find as you go to the next slide, I've put some pointers there for you to look at. Now you have nature, which is also the space of freedom, which is also the space of where human beings can do what they like and as they desire, as against the space of industrialization and captivity. And you will notice that Paul Morel, who enjoys this kind of natural life that he has around in the countryside, when he is forced to go to the Jordan's factory, he feels that industrialization and he feels that industrialism is hanging heavy on him. And it is this clash between the individual and society that you find as the pertinent one of the pertinent themes of Sons and Lovers as well. We'll return to this in a bit. But then the next point that I'd like you to look at is the idea of the exploration of sexuality. It is one of those important points in Lawrence that have been, you know, criticized or lauded for the complexity in relationships, the you know, relationships which you know, keep changing their power equation in terms of dominance and dependence. You know, in some cases it's the relationship is defined by dependence, in the other case it is defined by dominance. So this shift keeps taking place between dominance and dependence and defines relationships and also in a way defines sexualities in the text. Let's go further. The spiritual and the sensual. This is again one of those perennial kind of a dichotomy in Lawrence, you know, whether to highlight, whether to go with the spiritual or go with the sensual. He of course is goes with the body more than the spirit, and the spirit must follow the body in Lawrence, and he believes that the sensual will show the way to spiritual. So you know, it's that kind of a tricky situation, and I mean the contestation between the two occupies much of Lawrence's works. And then the tenets of modernism, as we were discussing, the self-aware, self-conscious hero, the alienated subject who depicts this modern consciousness of being completely lonely and helpless in surroundings. And within this, you know, what rescues actually Lawrence from modernism is this desire for emotional stability. And this is what the desire for emotional stability actually, in a way, gives a sense of direction to Lawrence's works, in the sense that even as he knows that one is alienated, helpless and self-conscious, there is this desire to find that emotional stability that Sons and Lovers Paul was able to find in his mother. His mother was a source of constant life support for him. She was the center and you know, and the point of emotional stability in his life. And the moment he loses that center at the end of the novel, he's in an abyss. He's almost like the last chapter is titled Derelict. He is almost sent away and is deserted in that sense, right? So these are some of the points that I thought you should know about Lawrence, including something about Lawrence's language and poetic use of language. He builds these detailed descriptions. There is, and the use of natural image, battle imagery, among others, they add to this kind of clash in the novel, you know, where on one side there is this, there is this fight to get ahead in life, and the battle imagery serves there, and on the other, this kind of a rhythmic life that the natural imagery carries. So these, and there are these symbolic references in the novel that add to that kind of the quality of the theme. You know, it's the symbolic references, for instance, in Sons and Lovers, when Walter Morel chops off the hair of beautiful curls of William, right? Or the blood that gets stuck in Paul's hair. You know, all those points seem to have larger than the, you know, they don't stay in that moment and die. They seem to resonate. They seem to keep coming back in the novel as a kind of a reference point to which and so the novelist does not want you to forget those moments, you know, where the moment when Miriam is scared to offer her hand, for the hens to peck, you know, the scene of pecking in a way is almost a kind of, and all these references actually have a very sensual, erotic sense as well, in the sense that the Miriam's inability to put her hand and let the bird peck, let hens peck, Miriam's inability to take that swing and the thrust that the force that she gets from Paul, all of these seem to have erotic references as well. But you know, again, these are all symbolic, and so they remain in that subtle area of interpretation. And you'd find, as you go along Sons and Lovers, you'd find many more cases of this kind. But I wanted you to be conscious of his poetic use of language, his use of symbols, the use of imageries, and how he builds on them, how he keeps returning to them in the novel, as characters remember a particular episode from life. Let's look at some of the major themes. Now, let me straight away give you first the themes, and then, time permitting, we'll look at some of them. So, the critique of marriage is one of the important themes in Sons and Lovers. Marriage as it stands between Gertrude and Walter Morel, the parents of Paul, or as Clara and Baxter Dawes, the new age couple. So, you know, the exploration and the estrangement that takes place in marriage in both cases. In the case of Clara and Baxter, they just separate and decide to live together, live away because they are the new age couple. But then Gertrude and Walter Morel are the traditional couple who stick together, but Gertrude has lost all love for Walter Morel. And you find that disillusioned in marriage, Gertrude turned to the child. She turned from the father. So, and his nature was purely sensuous, that is Walter Morel's, and she strove to make him moral and religious, and in the process she actually destroyed him. So, you know, how marriage has actually destroyed Walter Morel, and because his wife would expect him to be a man within courts and be responsible and earn and give a better life to the family, and that he's unable to do. So there is estrangement in this kind of marriage where the roles that Walter Morel is supposed to fulfill, he's unable to do so precisely because his nature is one which is sensuous and which is more spontaneous and doesn't believe in these responsibilities. But Gertrude is morally upright and she would want that such a husband. So there is disillusionment and estrangement in marriage, and the novel explores these different situations to tell us that the inability of couples to live along in that sense. So in seeking to make him nobler, she actually destroyed him. On his part, Walter is of course violent. He abuses Gertrude. He's uncouth, he's irresponsible. He could scarcely spare the children an extra penny and brought them any apples. It all went in drink. So he's not a traditional father in that sense, a responsible father. Then that is one of the issues you should look at. The other issue is class divide, which is something that the novel keeps returning to at different points in time. The first case where you see this coming up is the first part of the novel, which is totally based on the life of miners and the community of miners and the cultures that they have, wherein they are exhausted. Like Walter is totally exhausted in his job and is wearied. He cannot think. The day when Paul is born, for instance, he cannot go and meet Gertrude. He's just too tired. He wants to have his food and sleep. So there is this dreary endurance of this community, the ugliness of that, of that life, that gets projected here in the first part of the novel. And in the second part of the novel, really, Paul, as he comes in contact first with Miriam, and you know, there it's his ideas about religion that he tries to bring forth, you know, how religion plays an important role in life, and Miriam plays an important role there in his life to tell him that. From that point, when he comes in contact with Clara, now, of course, this novel has faced a lot of flack from feminists because, feminists such as Kate Millett, who have argued that he was basically very chauvinistic, that Lawrence has, it's his actually detestation for women and his centralizing the consciousness of Paul that has given this novel a kind of coloring which is quite misogynistic, and claiming that, you know, that there is this sense that the women are looked down upon. Now that is true to some extent, but it is also true that Paul is changing when he, and that also contributes to actually an important part point of this novel, which is that this is a novel of Bildungsroman. Now, the novel of Bildungsroman is one which charts the growth of Paul, the intellectual and spiritual growth of Paul, the child who attains manhood, so to speak, right? And there is this awareness of his class position, his education and his manners. What is also then central is that Paul, as he comes in contact with Miriam, begins to think of life as a religious kind of a journey and believes in its mysticism. He's at least intrigued by it if he doesn't entirely believe in it. Miriam is a person who is with full intensity religious, and she believes in this mystical world and lives in her world of her own. Paul is intrigued by that world. He doesn't entirely believe it, but there is a very a huge chunk of Miriam in Paul, and yet he gets changed when he comes to meet Clara. Of course, he has a very kind of a twisted view of her life, and he thinks her to be this kind of a woman who actually desires love but is playing the feminist, and he looks down upon her. But at the same time, when he gets close to her, he goes to these different meetings, you know, the suffragette meeting, for instance, and several other intellectual meetings, political meetings, and then in that moment, he's able to look at life differently. He doesn't altogether hate his father, something that his mother had taught him to do, something that so Gertrude seems to be living her dream through her children in that sense. She wants them to get big in life. She wants them to climb to the well-to-do middle class. You see, if you look at the screen, you will notice this is what Paul says to his mother. He says, and I quote, "I don't want to belong to the well-to-do middle class. I like my common people best. I belong to the common people." End quote. Another quote, he says, only from the middle classes one gets ideas. From the common people, life itself, warmth. End quote. Now, look at these quotes. This doesn't look like this is a son, this is Gertrude's son. Now, Gertrude Morrell, all her life, has been pinning her hopes on the lives of her sons, who she, you know, terms lovers. You see, the title of the novel in the plural is Sons and Lovers, sons who in the process become lovers, because Gertrude realizes that her husband will not be able to provide her with that kind of life that she's been desiring and yearning for, that she wants to climb up to the middle class life. And she moves away from the husband and begins to pin her hopes on the sons, who in time become her lovers. And of course, this novel has been looked at from the point of view of the Oedipus complex, wherein there are references that how this novel is actually Oedipal, in the sense that there is a mother fixation in both William and Paul, and which is why they are unable to find fulfillment in other women. In fact, Frank Kermode has gone on to also suggest that this essay by Freud on this kind of perennial kind of problem with erotic life, he says, is one wherein the male subject suffers from what he calls a kind of a psychic impotence, which means that because one is so fixed on the mother object and is divided between affection and sexual inclinations, therefore cannot find fulfillment. And that is one way of looking at the novel, where Paul could not find any fulfillment with Miriam, simply because Miriam was the mirror image of her, of the mother, in a foil also, but also a mirror image. She's as righteous and morally upright as the mother, so he cannot fulfill that, consummate his love with her because of the angle of the mother, and that is because he's unable to have that relationship with Miriam, and that he cannot put affection and the sexual inclination together, and therefore in order to fulfill his passions, he must go to somebody who is lower in order, who cannot evoke affection in him, and that becomes the woman Clara for him. So these are the different dimensions of the novel, really speaking, you know, from the middle class angle, from the class divide angle, from the industrial angle, you know, industrialism making its way, making Paul a kind of a prisoner of industrialism. This is a quote from the novel. It says that he's 14 and looking for a job, and the narrator says already he was a prisoner of industrialism. He was being taken into bondage. His freedom in the beloved home valley was over now. So you see, these are instances where the business world, the regulated world of the city or industrialism, the cellar of gloom and desolation where he stays for a very long time, it's his health suffers for it, and we know William dies in the novel because he is unable to cope with this world of industrialism. So you know, on the one, so if you look at it in that sense, you know, there was when the novel begins, the bottoms, the place where the family lives, we are given an overview of how that changed, in the sense that there were some miners, but then there is a company which comes in and you know, it's a company that establishes itself and makes a mining community, and you know, the there are different mines, a lot of mines that are littered all over the place. So Walter Morel, how is Walter Morel's life different from William's or Paul's? He has been living in, you know, he goes every day under the ground and lives out his life the whole day there, doesn't get to see the sun. That has been his life as a miner. But when William is in the city in London, he suffers, he gets pneumonia because he's unable to cope with that world. When Paul goes to work at the Jordan's firm, he suffers from this kind of gloom, and lack of air and darkness gives him pneumonia, you know. So how is this darkness and lack of air that is there in a dingy room in a factory different from the miner that Walter Morel was? It seems to get worse. And so you know, there is this kind of irreversible harm that it does to all these characters, and yet at the end you find that Paul is all ready to go back to that life. You know, there is this sense of what is the resolution? Where does Lawrence really see his protagonist? This protagonist, who has built up and has built a self, has overcome all his problems. He's not that self-conscious hero that he was at one point in time, you know. And he suffered the tortures of shyness, for instance, at one point in time. Paul at the Jordan's factory. Then he, you know, he felt crumpled up and lonely. He wanted, and this is the end really, when he has lost his mother. Now Paul felt crumpled up and lonely. He wanted someone of their own free initiative to help him, and feeling unsubstantial, shadowy, as if he did not count for much in this concrete world, he drew himself together, smaller and smaller. So and this is where probably it fits in with the modernist theme, right? That an educated man like Paul, who could have made much of his life, is unable to do so. So I think this inability to cope with industrialism is also what modernism is all about. What do you say? Do you agree with it?
No. First, I appreciate the analysis that you have given of the novel. There was some kind of mythicism there, in that the father figure, the son, the mother, the tussle between the woman and the man and all that. And that gives, you know, insights into the working of the main character's mind. I particularly liked the word consciousness, and as if, you know, Paul is a learner. So a person who is a learner and who is developing consciousness, I think that frees him from the clutches of what you call modernism.
I think, you know, on the contrary, I feel that the journey of Paul is very enriching, in the sense, I mean, of course, he's a complete chauvinist, but that also, you know, he's a chauvinist when he meets Clara in the beginning, but he changes his opinion of her as he meets her and he's being with her, and he questions himself, that is he right in questioning her way of life when his is as bad in that sense. So I think he's also evolving and changing his stance. You know, initially he would say that, oh, women are all good for home and they're not good for the labor market, etc.
And he changes for the better.
But, you know, towards the end, let me just tell you how the novel ends. Maybe that, in a way, the chapter derelict, right? The real agony was that he had nowhere to go, nothing to do, nothing to say, and was nothing himself. And finally, the last bit I want to add here, the end, and this is how the novel ends. But no, he would not give in. Turning sharply, he walked towards the city's gold phosphorescence. His fists were shut, his mouth set fast. He would not take the direction to the darkness to follow her. He walked towards the faintly humming, glowing town quickly. End quote.
This is a hopeful kind of an ending.
Right. So, you know, he seems to be, you know, it somehow reminds me of, you know, I mean, it's far-fetched, but Balzac's Old Goryeo, where you have Rastignac towards the end, standing on the cliff and deciding what he should do. He's also lost, you know, so, a friend, and he's completely in a crisis situation, and then he decides to head to the city. So there is contradiction, you know, when this kind of a contradiction in Paul really is one where you know, he's unable to cope with these women. He's able to free himself from the mother finally, and then he's in an abyss. He doesn't know where to find that emotional support, and he feels he's nothing and nobody cares for him. And then this movement towards finding something, that quest, you know, the modernist quest, that in a way comes back to him at the end.
Suppose I ask this question from you, that and it has emerged from your analysis also, that the villain in this novel is industrialism. Would you agree?
Yes, of course. That is certainly there, because the joy of life and the war of life is really taken away from that kind of industrialism, which is what I said. You know, how is Paul different from William, and how is William different from Walter Morel? They've all been victims of this industrialism.
Slightly outside this novel, what is wrong with replacing the word industrialism with capitalism?
Yes, that I think is a valid point, that this is a kind of a take on capitalism rather than industrialism. And Lawrence, in that sense, actually, when he talks about building a communist kind of a world, and he says, let's go to an island and build our own utopian world, he seems to be suggesting would we say that Lawrence is not against industry per se? I can't say that. Is he against this kind of competitive world where they must succeed, where the pressure coming from family, in the case of Sons and Lovers, Gertrude Morel, to make it big in life remains, and both William and Paul can't survive. In fact, Gertrude at one point says that, I know you will not be able to survive. As I look at it, you keep working and working and never seem to get anywhere. He's okay with being, he says, the working class people. He's okay with being with the common people, as Paul says. And yet there is a tragedy that Gertrude is able to see in her own life, and also in her sons. She saw first that in her husband, but then she sees that as much in the sons, and that is the tragedy of the middle class existence, or the lower middle class existence, really.
So, friends, we end with this particular point that Dr. Richa Bajaj has made. The point is that industrialism has to go, and it has to be replaced by something. And Lawrence is not very clear about what's the answer and where the issue can be resolved. But then all kinds of questions are opened up at the end, and there's food for thought, as he said, and this novel takes us to other novels of Lawrence later. So with this kind of conclusion that leads to other writing of Lawrence, we conclude, and I hope you enjoyed the lecture. Thank you.